Welcome back. We're now going to begin our third and final session, Ways of Dying, Ways of Mourning. Our two speakers for this session are, first will be Mayra Rivera, who's professor of religion and Latino studies at Harvard Divinity School. She specializes in the ethical dimensions of contemporary Christian thought. Her research interests include conceptions of race, gender, and coloniality in the integration of the study of philosophical and literary texts, with particular attention to Latino, and Caribbean sources. Her work in religious studies engages key Christian themes in relation to current philosophy and theories of gender, coloniality, ethnicity, and race. She's affiliated with Harvard's Committee on Ethnicity, Migration, and Rights, the Department of Romance Languages and Literatures, and the American Studies Program. Her most recent book, Poetics of the Flesh, published in 2015, explores the connections between theological, philosophical, and political metaphors of body and flesh. It has been my great pleasure since, but even before the opening of the Salcedo Show, to teach with Mayra, or at least speak with several of her classes. And for me, each time, it's been like today, in which I've learned from the questions and the perspective of those who are not in the field of art history, and may also be in the field of art history, but the varied perspectives that really enrich the thought of what this work is about and why we should think about it in different ways. Our second speaker will be Kimberley Patton. Kimberley is professor of the Comparative and Historical Study of Religion, also at the Harvard Divinity School. She specializes in ancient Greek religion and archaeology, and also researches topics in the history of religion, such as dreams and dream interpretation, animals and religion and myth, religion and the natural world, iconography and iconoclasm, twinship and lamentation. She is, her publications include The Sea Can Wash Away All Evils, Modern Marine Pollution, and The Ancient Cathartic Ocean. And more recently, her book, Religion of the Gods, Ritual, Paradox, and Reflexivity, won the 2010 American Academy of Religion Book Award for Excellence in Descriptive Analytical Studies. She also recently published a study of ritual in a maternal mortality burial at the Neolithic site, which I won't be able to pronounce, in central Anatolia, in Religion at Work in a Neolithic Society, Vital Matters, in 2014. She's now working on a book called Our Mother's Bones, Religion and the Dilemma of Human Enchainment, forthcoming next year. She holds a PhD and an MA in the study of religion from Harvard, as well as her BA. I welcome you both. I look forward to learning from you, and then I will be moderating after their talks. Please, Mayra, let's welcome.
Thank you. Thanks for coming, and thank you, Mary. This has been such a delightful conversation. As the title of the exhibition, The Materiality of Mourning, suggests, the theme of mourning is presented by its very materiality. So the materiality is itself a theme. Grief is always embodied, of course, and thus always material. And so is mourning. But in Salcedo's works, the bodies of the victims are not represented, nor are the bodies of those who mourn, nor is the body of the artist. By refusing to represent bodies, it forces us to acknowledge the absence of the body, of any body. In this space, we can contemplate that absence as irreparable loss. With nothing to represent the source of violence or its object, our bodies feel exposed. Still, the absence is not emptiness, and observation is not passivity. At some level, evoking an absent body is a familiar theme for a scholar of religion. So familiar, indeed, that it took me very long to think about addressing it in relation to the exhibit. At some level, I may have been foolishly assuming that you all were thinking about this old, old debate and the Protestant accusations against the Catholic practices of venerating the relics of saints, praying with icons, or depicting Jesus on the cross. The claims that representations of the image, or sometimes the name, can deceive us, leading us to substitute the image for the event, closing it around itself too quickly, is perhaps relevant for the arguments about the challenges and dangers of offering pictorial representations of bodies, particularly the bodies of victims. And I think the conversation we just had ties directly into this. But the debates are never as simple as the parties represent them. And this is, I think, part of Sergio's point. And a historian of early Christianity, Patricia Cox Miller, has argued that early Christian thinkers used a broad range of techniques to, quote, achieve the conjunction of discourse, materiality, and meaning. Their view of the power of the bodies of saints was based on what she calls the poetics of matter, in order to help readers to develop an ability to apprehend the spirit in the material world. The aesthetic qualities of language were used to provoke sensible responses in order to transform the imaginative and thus the perceptive abilities of readers. While Salcedo clearly refuses the pictorial representation of bodies, she relies on the power of material qualities of the objects to provoke sensible responses to signify the loss, as she puts it. And already I'm struggling with the complexity here because these pieces are not abstract representations of an event of violence against a body, but rather a memory of the event. But memories bring together both the force of the event and the absence that is only experienced after the event, the perspective of the witness. Signifying loss, particularly as a work of mourning, is not a simple reference to a presence that is now lost. For it to register as loss, it must appeal to relations between the life lost, the materiality of the objects, and our own bodies. So I'm going to speak first about the materiality and temporality of the pieces, and finally about the irreparability of the past. The density, depth, and temporality of each of the pieces can be interpreted as a kind of ontology, or better, a poetics of the relations between the living body, materiality, time, memory, and meaning. Each piece, though, seems to be a different configuration of these relations, or perhaps a different moment in that configuration. So I explore them individually. Let me see if I can. There is a subdued feeling to the exhibition. It invites us to slow down. But when we do, when we pay attention to the details, we see that there are different temporalities at play. The wooden pieces in the first room, which is the one here, appear fixed, a sense that is only reinforced by realizing that the armors are filled with cement. They are heavy. They seem unmovable. But on a closer look, we see the marks that evoke the traces of a living body. Marks produced very slowly by quotidian acts repeated through time. The marks around the edges of the place where she used to sit, a surface stained by wet hands, or a cup where she always used to sit, the red stain on that plank of wood. I imagine that the door of the armor, the escaparate, as Mary reminded us, must be marked by the ways she grabbed its door every day. Slowly, these apparently inconsequential actions have shaped the bodies of the victims, bodies that are now lost, perhaps unrecognizable. And those bodies also shaped the surfaces of these objects that now silently show the inscriptions of the touch of an irreplaceable life, or so we imagine. But filled with cement, these same pieces that once extended the functional boundaries of a body conjure also simultaneously sudden and violent force that all but erase the signs of those vital connections. The same is true for the chairs. They show the marks of bodies made slowly by repeated use day after day, unique marks we seldom notice. But these crumpled, broken, and scattered chairs also evoke the sudden force that ended the life. It's hard to tell which marks are which. The reflections on their stainless steel surface make the marks more noticeable, but the material, its coolness and sharpness, breaks through any sense of familiarity. The strangeness of memory is more evident here than in the armors. Sharp, heavy steel makes the sharp break in the sense of time. The density of these pieces provokes sensible responses in me, as if these objects could call forth the weight of my own body, its lightness in relation to the gravity of the world. Their presence weighs on me. Gravity draws us toward the earth, and it troubles, it concerns us, as Jean-Luc Nancy observes. Building on the etymological proximity between to wait, pesar, and to think, pensar, Nancy brings materiality to bear on thinking. It is a gravity to be felt, the seriousness of thought as in the pressures of it exerts in our bodies. The existence of the world is grave, he says. Thought is letting what weighs weigh. Feeling the weight, the heaviness of things is the very possibility of thought. Yet things weigh outside of us, away from us. Weight is the very inappropriability of the objects. We are exposed to the weight of the world, to the unexplainable reality of our very existence in relationships that we cannot fully represent, and to the enormity of human injustice, the weight of materiality, its resistance to appropriation, the significance of density and gravity. From the first to the last room, the pieces lose their denseness. we've seen. We contemplate fragility and exposure rather than stability and weight. A flor de piel, both a flower offering and a shroud, is an expansive surface. The title, literally, at the flower of the skin, is an idiomatic phrase that referred to the processing of leather to bringing to the surface the innermost skin. The phrase is commonly used to describe a strong feeling that cannot be contained, that will surface easily at the slightest provocation. It implies the coincidence of raw emotion and physical sensitivity. Feeling at the surface of one's skin. In this case, the feeling evoked is both the vulnerability of the victim and the response of the artist moved to create an expansive offering. And perhaps you have noticed that most of us kneel or bow down or lower ourselves in front of the piece when we enter the room. As a shroud, it would have covered a body. Without the body, the skin-like piece reminds us that skin is both the site of the loving touch and the exposure to harm. The petals are held together by visible sutures that can easily come apart. Built of rose petals, a flor de piel is not only thin, but ephemeral. In fact, an interesting element of the piece is that the artist has found a way to extend the life of the petals without occluding their fragility. This one is suspended in time as the next one. This remembered seems to be suspended in space. In time, organic matter loses its density, and so does memory. By giving the petals more time, it gives us a little more time. Eventually, this too will be lost unless the work of the artist is undertook as her funerary oration is repeated by others. The museum is now committed to preserving it, to in fact continue the work. Salcedo describes her work as a topology of mourning, as a poetics of mourning. The topology calls attention to the spatial relations between the pieces, between the rooms that comprise the exhibition. Space in the installation evokes absence, like the pieces do, more loss than the pieces can contain. But I personally like the expression of poetics of mourning because it brings together space and temporality. It evokes silence, that of repression, but also that of the time needed to mourn, to respond. The irreparable. Art can inscribe in our life a different kind of passage, that is, from suffering to signifying loss, Salcedo writes. The only possible response I can give to the face of irreparable absence is to produce images capable of conveying incompleteness, lack, and emptiness. The passage does not promise redemption. Time, which is a condition of human existence, is above all a condition that is irreparable, Emmanuel Levinas writes in The Politics of Hitlerism. In his view, both Judaism and Christianity offer practices that can nonetheless redeem us from the past. Quote, Judaism bears this magnificent message. Remorse, the painful expression of a radical powerlessness to redeem the irreparable, heralds the repentance that generates the pardon that redeems. Time loses its very irreversibility, he writes. Similarly, he argues that Christianity has its own means to overcome the past. The salvation that Christianity wishes to bring us lies in the way it promises to reopen the finality brought about by the flow of moments of a past that is forever challenged, forever called into question, end quote. I would argue with Levinas' representation at least a bit, or ask us to think about what is possible in this repair that he imagines. But I'm interested in his emphasis on these traditions that require work in relation to mend something, and also to contrast his vision from that of Salcedo. In contrast, for Salcedo, the passage that art offers does not mend, but signifies loss itself. Not a reparation, not a promise of a reconstituted body or a healed heart, not even an appeal to a God to deliver us from the evil or bring peace. It makes evident the impossibility of a caress, of healing, or, and of saving from the abyss of death, as she puts it. The past remains irreparable. We stand speechless. But considering the work of the artist, of Salcedo, as responses, we are already confronting questions of another time, spaces of transformation. Our very humanity resides within the devotion or contempt that we assign to our practice, processes, and rituals of mourning, Salcedo writes. An aesthetic view of death reveals an ethical view of life, she adds. It is at this personal juncture that the personal orientation toward the victim and the acts of devotion take public significance. As Judith Butler argues, many people think that grief is privatizing, that it returns us to a solitary situation, and is in that sense depoliticizing. But I think it furnishes a sense of political community of a complex order by bringing to the fore the relational ties that have implications for theorizing fundamental dependency and ethical responsibility, end quote. So I return to the image of suturing in these works to think of the ways in which it does not seem to promise to repair a past. The ties cannot be repaired even if the bodies of the victims were returned, or as Ana Maria observed, even as Mary observed, even if the land is returned. But our last conversation was moving us to think about what is it then that stitching can accomplish. Something is stitched together, perhaps our very humanity, perhaps our ability to see our primary ties to one another. Thank you.
It's such an honor to be here. I would like to thank Mary Schneider Enriquez for this visionary symposium, for the exhibit. I was so moved to hear and I'm sure everyone else already knows that, that the Harvard Art Museums have has acquired a fleur de piel for our permanent collection. I'm just overwhelmed and so grateful to hear that. Before I introduce my wonderful student, Professor Kaith Heller, to read a poem that she wrote for us to close this wonderful symposium, I just wanted to dedicate my talk, my remarks, to my daughter Christina, who saw part of this exhibit in Miami. And when I was invited by Mary, said, "Mom, you have to, you just have to, you have to." And so unfortunately, she was not able to come, speaking of the absent one. But I want to dedicate it to her, my daughter, who suffered violence, who did not die. So I just wanted to introduce Kaith Heller, who is an artist and a poet, published poet. She works deeply with themes of mourning, loss, and transformation. She's also a professor of poetry at Bard College and a PhD candidate here in the study of religion and critical media practice. And thank you, Mary, for allowing Kaith to read an original poem that she wrote for the symposium and in honor of Doris Salcedo and for us. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kimberly and Mary and Mayra. Salcedo describes how, quote, "when the spectator gives the work a moment of silent contemplation, in that moment and only in that moment, connection happens, as if the victim's destroyed life, cut short at the time of the murder, might or could in some way continue within the spectator's experience." The poem I will read likewise moves in its address between maker and audience, addressing a you who might be at times yourselves, myself, Salcedo, or the murdered nurse for whom Salcedo made a fleur de piel, as if to suggest how the second person encodes how we could all be latent potentialities of each other. Untitled. Inside me, a woman is kneeling, but I do not know her. Touching and not touching the shroud of roses she sews petal by petal on the floor. As if what our fingers touch could tell us what we have lost. How everything will be lost. You can hear her sharp keening as roses disremember into a new shape. As if what is absent in touch could speak through you. As if you remember everything that had yet to happen. And the awkwardness of the shroud, ceaselessly trying to arrange itself without the body. As if only being dead were fragile enough for what the earth had to say. Inside me, her eyes grow darker. Blackened needles sewing a spectral garment you remember and forget. "Your body gets smoky," she says silently. "Gets holes in it." A country you can no longer tolerate, precarious as space and time, two forms of motion that cross in a desire of which the body is an unappeasable metaphor. the mark a needle makes as it appears and disappears between the folds. Inside me, a woman is kneeling. Returning home after a long journey to find home no longer there. Her body sutures the dark border between Columbia and the moon, between things that enclose you and things you cannot touch. They are so near. Something sobbing in her all the time, all the time. The small flame in you shivers and shivers like an eye. Climb in, part your shattered chest like a veil, and lick at the rose petals welling over your bones. They have nothing to do with your happiness or grief.
Thank you so much, Kai, with all our hearts. In 2015, reviewing the Guggenheim Museum's retrospective of Doris Salcedo's melancholy art, poised, as he wrote, between memorialization and oblivion, art critic Jason Varago asked, is Doris Salcedo our civilization's official mourner? Our civilization's official mourner. Steeped as the past century, and certainly what we've lived of in this century, that is a tall order. The academic love affair with granular particularity pushes back on this, as is true of all of us, Salcedo's wellspring, as many have observed, must necessarily be profoundly local and particular. Her birth in Bogota in 1958, expressing itself through her Jewishness, and I would argue her Latino-Roman Catholicism, her experience as one who's lived through the horrors of countless kidnappings, tortures, and killings of her native country, and who has spent months and now years of her life with afflicted Colombian families, searching with mothers for their sons and daughters secuestrados without even a body to bury. This is very particular, and especially when confronted with the intimacy of lives lost so terribly and bodies missing, with the folded crucified linen shirts or the voluminous wounded shroud of rose petal for a murdered body that died far away and increasingly long ago, we may feel as though we could only respect and look away. We may be perhaps ambivalently both shocked and drawn to the awful beauty of her work. We wonder if Salcedo is having a private funeral and did not invite us, a funeral for which she, in some sense, mourns alone. The opposite of this turns out to be true. Salcedo herself says something else in an interview in 2015. She says, she acknowledges so humbly and bravely that there's no efficacy, no redemption in her work. She acknowledges the futility of her own work to affect history or even to comfort the afflicted. She says, I don't think art can solve problems. I'm not doing anything for these families. And it's a reality we have to, I'm not doing anything for these victims, and it's a reality we have to face when we talk about this kind of art. Second, she says that there is no exclusion. Even if I'm not Latina, even if I'm not a woman, even if I've never lost anyone, even to a natural death, she says all are welcome to join her in witness and in mourning through the portal of our own unique memories of pain. Even though Colombia is the country of unburied death, of the unmarked grave, unlike our own, we are welcome, we are invited to the funeral, and perhaps to our own rebirth. As Kite's poem expresses, Salcedo can kneel within each one of us, hand-stitching the petals of a flor de piel, the flower of the skin, the nurse's shroud, our own shroud. We can be in relationship to her. We can do so through the portal of our own pain. And third, she says that creating beauty out of trauma, as Mayra was speaking about, trauma of the worst kind that destroys the souls of parents and children and communities, may seem unholy. Salcedo echoes Theodore Adorno in this, as he reflected on the poetry of the Romanian Jewish poet Paul Celan, born Paul Anschel. And so she says it's difficult to deal with horrible events and tragic events and turn all that pain into beauty. That's something I find perverse. Now, as a historian of religion, I'm interested that we so often hear this quote in written work about Salcedo, but we don't hear often the rest of what she said. She said, on the one hand, I think that, but on the other, I think that if you want to dignify human life, then you have to come back to beauty, because that's where we find dignity and almost turn it into a sacred space. That's the level of beauty that should be present in the work. A fleur de piel requires a level, an appreciation of a level of beauty and a level of effort that can answer the horror and indignity of the death that provoked it. This is the Arthur and Frieda Stern Mount Carmel Cemetery in Philadelphia, recently vandalized. Rabbi Sean Zevit of Mishkan Shalom Synagogue, associated with this cemetery, says that in the Jewish tradition, caring for the dead, this was his comment to the news, caring for the dead is the ultimate test of love and loyalty. The opposite, in a sense, of what our culture encourages. Our culture where it's illegal to prepare our own dead bodies, where we need special permission, often denied, to bury a body in a non-degrading steel box, to bury it in a shroud. We're encouraged, in a sense, tacitly, not to visit our dead too often, lest our relatives think we have complicated grief and sign us up for help. In Baros, and an island in the Cyclades, and many other places around the world, the dead are visited every single night. The fact is that I think we don't hear the rest of that quote because in our Western love of alienation and plot twists, we like the last sentence, the last word of that where it ends, the perverse part. We've increasingly lost our religious imagination and we're out of touch with the frameworks, which are Salcedo's, into which cultures used to fit the loneliness and weirdness and sadness of human experience because we confuse sacralization with sentimentality. The thing about the dead, and Judith Butler touched on this in her beautiful remarks last night, is that the dead have a tendency not to go away like trash, like anything that we think is outside, gone, that we're okay now, they don't. They especially if they've died violently and unjustly, the dead are actually dangerous. If their bodies disappear or their families too afraid to speak of them, they won't be silenced. And this is a very shared theme in many, many ancient traditions and modern traditions as well. They're not away because they're part of the extended family, which is why it is so powerful to hear Rabbi Zevit say of the toppled gravestones, in the Jewish tradition, caring for the dead is the ultimate test of love and loyalty. And I believe that Salcedo believes this deeply. It is common for women to mourn the dead. The grieving family's concentric circles widened by members of the community who were ritual experts in weeping over the body of the deceased. Here we have mourners surrounding the body of a male elder in northeastern Georgia in 1910. But this scene plays out in present times in Greece, in Russia, everywhere in the world. Yep, I'm just going to do it this way, but that's not fun. Okay, it's all right. There was often a woman who was a chief mourner. That remains true. The laments are personal and hard to bear, as Lauren Ninochvili has, who've worked on this, comments. The day has dawned, Agato, the day has dawned. Are you still sleeping? You address the dead, or you address the mourners. People, why are you surprised I'm crazy or overtaken with madness? I've lost a child. May God dry up my tears. They're like shards of rock, people heavy. I myself should be wept for. I am sorrow itself. Even death is called out. Death, if you're so easy, why didn't you die once yourself? Why didn't you melt like snow in the sun? And as many have commented, from Margaret Alexiou on, the lament itself becomes a form of resistance, not only against these existential questions, but against political regimes that may have been complicit in the death of the loved one. And so briefly, I thought it would be interesting for us, before answering this question of whether Salcedo is our civilization's chief mourner, just to look at this playing out in a few antique cultures. One is ancient Greece. This is a terracotta geometric period funeral plaque. It shows the prothesis, the laying out of the body. And again, we see mostly women involved here. These may be relatives, or some of them may be joining from the community. But I would like to just point out, first of all, the care and the tenderness with which the dead person is treated before being buried. Not to have a proper burial is an insult to human dignity, back to Salcedo's invocation of dignity and beauty. This comes up in the Iliad. The Psyche of Patroclus complains that Achilles hasn't buried him and he's wandering. Or Elpenor in the Odyssey, do not leave me unburied and unwept. Odysseus says, I didn't even know you were dead. You know, I'm sorry. Failure to do so results in a terrible scene like this of Achilles dragging the corpse of Hector, this beautiful Hydrea, which is in the Boston Museum of Fine Arts. I want to point out two things about it. First of all, the gods try to stop this. The gods themselves, that is Nike, or Iris, it may be Iris, a winged figure, who is sent to plead for a ransom of Hector's body. But looking back, Achilles is actually looking back. I don't have a pointer, but it'll probably blow up the whole thing. So let's see. Nope, that would be too much fun. If you look at the upper left, you'll see Achilles looking back as he commits this act of horror at two people standing in a portal. Those are the parents of Hector. So those are Priam and Hecuba. And those are the ones that he looks into their eyes, knowing what he is doing to them, knowing the pain he's causing them. The thing about attic gravestones is you often can't tell who is the dead. It's an interesting mystery. The mother mourning, the child reaching, it may be the mother saying goodbye to the child who's being carried away by the nurse. Maybe both have died. The point is the connection is severed, and I want to return to this in just a minute. The connection between mother and child is a lot weirder than we thought. It turns out that across, and this is a, this is a beautiful image recently published in National Geographic in Tanzania of a mother and daughter by Nahum Weiss. It turns out that across the placental barrier, mother and child in utero exchange cells. They're called microchimera. They end up swapping, they end up living permanently. So, and they provide autoimmunity in the maternal brain. Childbirth creates two people who are not only related, but actually in some sense literally part of one another. And this does amazing things to their first world obsession with self-hooded individuality. We live on in our mother's bones, brains, and blood, and they in ours. When our mother is buried, we bury ourselves and vice versa. That is painful enough, but when there's no body to bury, no object of the dirge, a mother is literally, not figuratively, permanently disoriented. Why do the families of Malaysia Airlines Flight 370 say that 3 years of searching the desolate seabed of the Indian Ocean for the remains of their loved ones is not enough? Those are not enough. That is not long enough, period. And this is Puranjit Gangobadai's life cycle of a mother and daughter, who mother is apprenticing to make pots in Gujarat. So mourning is, as Mayra mentioned, not just remembering, it's resurrecting. Mothers knit their children together in the womb, as the psalm says, but if your child dies, you need to recreate that child. You need to stitch that child back together. On the Blasket Islands, for example, there's a wonderful account before they were evacuated in Ireland of a mother whose son died violently on the rocks in a fishing boat. And she tells how they brought him back and laid him on the kitchen table, back to tables. And she said, and I put his face back together. I put his face back together. She had made it in the beginning. She needed to recreate it. In other words, there is a way in which a mother's job is to reverse the fragmentation of the body of her child. And we think of the work of Salcedo along these lines. This is the orphan's tunic, which is made of wood, human hair, and silk. That's a close-up inspired by the dress worn by an orphan girl who saw her parents killed before her, the dress her mother had made. The Orthodox Christian liturgy has a beautiful line in it where the soul asks God to deliver me to my original beauty. Let's see. I need some help. Sorry, not advancing. Yep. The dead is already childlike. The dead is so much like a child or even an infant, and we see parallels. The dead must be cleaned. The body fluids must be expressed. The dead must be swaddled like a child. This has been noticed and practiced for many, many years. When I was working at Çatalhöyük in Anatolia, as Mary mentioned, I was struck by how our Neolithic ancestors, this is a house, wanted to keep the dead close, not far away. In the corner, those horns of an auroch, or several aurochs, are actually guarding a platform burial, which every house had, of at least two or three skeletons. A house did not work if you did not have the dead under the floors, and in the granaries were the skeletons of infants. So the further away you were from your dead, the worse things were. You wanted them close at hand. You wanted them under the floors. I published a skeleton of a woman who died in childbirth, encircled in this way. The arrows show where the fetus is. And this is a schema, so you can see it. And that is one form of cradling a dead child. But there was another skeleton, actually a dual skeleton, that really brought this home. This is a skeleton of a woman who's actually cradling the skull of another dead person. This is around 6500 BC. And you can see that the skull has actually been remade. It has been plastered over to create a face. So the same fetal position as the skeleton we just saw, the dyadic skeleton of the mother and baby, but with a skull. We don't know the relationship, why that is so cherished. We do know that skulls were, and this is from Tel Aswad in Israel, but we see the same thing at Çatalhöyük from the Neolithic period, are reanimated, even their eyes are reinserted, are recreated with cowrie shells. And so I would argue that in this environment of extreme care for the dead, tender care for the dead, here we are at the cathedral in Santa Cruz, the Mompox in Colombia, people visiting graves, and again, a very, very regular occurrence. That this is the wellspring that Salcedo draws from. This is how it should be. And the question of if she is our civilization's official mourner continues to well up in that way when these customs, this way of being, is abrogated. Salcedo, I have said, and I would argue, draws from deep religious orientations, whether or not they're explicit, although they often are. There is her Jewishness, the ways in which this image, this horrifying image of a gas chamber in Auschwitz, might now I'm sorry. might now have inspired an abyss in which the ceiling of an abandoned Italian castle is actually drawn down to create a feeling of heaviness and a feeling of oppression. Or in which the collected shoes at Yad Vashem, as has often been noted, may, in their own way, have inspired the beautiful collection of shoes which are so carefully sewn in using animal skin into the 1992 work. All right, Mayra. Atrabilarios. Anywhere close? Okay, great. Defiances. The shoes of the disappeared. And just quickly on Fleur de Piel, this epidermis, the skin, this shroud. There is this attempt, as Salcedo has said, to perform the funerary ritual that was denied to the victim under the shroud that Salcedo has made for her, stitched together, as we have noted so often, the rose petals that are like the cells of her skin, preserving as well her wounds. And I think of my father, the surgeon, stitching. The dismembered nurse is not. Her body is absent, and as Kaith remarked to me last night, this is much bigger than it should be. Back to that issue of, is it for local and particular, or is it for universal? I think it's for both. This shroud, this skin, this thing of beauty and horror fills the room. It's oceanic, and it reminds me of Naomi Shahib Nye's poem, Kindness, about seeing the size of the cloth of sorrow. Shrouds are, of course, a very ancient way of caring for the dead, the infant dead, the helpless dead. This is a traditional Jewish funeral, a Hindu shroud prior to cremation. Note that shrouds are often covered with roses. They're often covered with flowers. But yet there's a particularity, a Colombian particularity to this. This is a spray of roses, as are sent all over the world from Colombia's famous rose industry, in, I would say, a very almost coffin-like box. These beautiful red roses that were the inspiration for A Fleur de Piel, being carried off in what to me looks like both a truck of transport and a hearse. There have been problems recently with Colombian roses being used to smuggle drugs, to smuggle cocaine. There have been problems with the kinds of chemicals used to preserve the roses and pesticides poisoning workers and making it toxic. There is, moving to Salcedo's, I would argue, her Roman Catholicism, there is the Virgin of Guadalupe who stands on roses and flowers. And this is one, I chose this one because even though she is Mexican, even though she spills her beautiful roses into the tunic of Juan Diego in Mexico, in Tepeyac, this is one from Bogota. And there is, behind her, there is the weeping virgin whose heart is pierced by the death of her son, the one who goes to anoint and to shroud his body and finds it not. And this is a weeping virgin from Quito. And this imagery, so very typical of Latino piety, especially Catholic piety, shows her as the chief mourner of her child, as was predicted by Simeon in the book of Luke. A sword will pierce your soul. So it is the mother who's the chief mourner of her child. It is the mother, Mary, who stands at the foot of the cross, laments her crucified lamb, her springtime. The body is dead, and yet you see it's almost that Jesus is looking at her in this medieval Italian painting, very orthodox iconographic, reminiscent because of its early date. Lemminkainen, the mother, aging mother in the finished Kalevala, dredges the river Tuoni with a giant rake of copper and silver to recover the torn body parts of her son, and she ends up reviving him with the help of a celestial bee, searching for the bodies. The Homeric hymns Demeter, searching the earth for her kidnapped daughter Persephone, starving the whole world in her furious grief, the mother of Siddhartha, the wife of Siddhartha, receiving the news of her husband's abandonment, Siddhartha, who named his child Little Fetter. Is Salcedo the official mourner of our civilization? I want to close by just moving to some actual bereaved mothers, not mythical ones. These are very recent. This is Saima, who is the mother of Mohammed Amanullah, Mohammed Zahir, and Mohammed Jawed, who died on the same day when Taliban militants attacked their outpost in Kandahar, Afghanistan. I want to just point out as we move quickly through these that these mothers are alone and yet supported by family, by community. I couldn't help but thinking of A Fleur de Piel when we see these beautiful red coverings upon their three graves on the hillside in Kandahar. The next day, they were covered in snow. Surely a kind of obsolescence, even though temporary, that Salcedo would understand. Shirley Chambers, who lost four children in Chicago to gun violence at the funeral of her fourth child several years ago, and we're reminded of Salcedo's new project, which is for the people of Chicago and trying to remember those names in water that appears and disappears. And if the mother's strong enough and pulling from that deep interlocking relationship like Mamie and Emmett Till, when the child is killed and the child is mutilated in injustice, it is she, if she can, if she's not prevented, who wants to show the world, who wants to display the body in this extraordinary and still terrifying and haunting photo that was taken when he was lynched and beaten and his body thrown into the Tallahatchie River for allegedly whistling at a white woman, although that was just recanted, actually, I think last month, and his murderers acquitted. Mamie's, who came down from Chicago to identify her son and told the funeral director, "Let the people see what I've seen." Behold your mother, woman, behold your son, woman, behold your daughter. The mother was determined to expose the barbarous of the crime, determined it should not be hidden in a casket. The public could no longer to pretend to ignore what they couldn't see. This is my own daughter, Christina. I want to close with this image. She was drugged and raped at age 18. Several years later, she appeared in an Edward Bond's play, Bingo, about the last week of Shakespeare's life. It was written in 1973. As this is part of her theater major at Barnard Columbia, she was cast as a whore and an arsonist. Who is beaten eventually and hanged. The director wanted her to basically play a corpse in a gibbet, a medieval and Renaissance gibbet, and had one custom made for my child. And I don't know if you can see, I took this with my phone, but there's a rope around her neck, a noose around her neck. And my daughter is a yogic practitioner, and so you could not see her chest rise. My friends told me, back to whether Salcedo has room in her witness for Kaith, for me, for any of us, no matter what our proximity to her particularity. My friends told me, don't go to that. Why would you want to see that? And I didn't want to, but I thought, well, this is a play. What if she actually were in a morgue? Would I not go to see her? Would I not go to claim her body? And then I thought, how would I console my friends who had lost their children if I could not go to the morgue? And so I did, and it was as close as I ever hoped to come to seeing my daughter dead. It was much too close, and it really broke my heart. But the fact that it was a representation is something that stands in tension with that. This fall, Christina took the stage to speak of Václav Havel, who said, "The greater the experience of absurdity, the greater the insistence on finding meaning." And in a part where the actors were allowed to break the fourth wall, she told the story of her drugging and her assault. And this is her about to turn and tell that story. It was actually taken by another actor from the stage. So. If Salcedo's goal were only political, her voice only one of outraged protest, even the fierce protest of lamentation against the fact of death, just or unjust, she would not travel to spend so much time with those bereaved and left behind, bodiless. She would not internalize their stories, even as she does not represent them specifically. Her art would not be so transpersonal, and it would not be so transpersonal. Yes, it is art of trauma, art as a scar, but it is also art of the resurrected body, the body of the child. So I think that she, in a sense, in the way that Elizabeth Schussef Fiorenza calls Mary Mariam, mourning Yeshua, I think she becomes a kind of universal mother. And I think in the materiality, in the attention, in the sewing, in the furniture, in the cement, in the grass that grows from the upside down tables, in the shoes, in making the shroud for the slain child, the daughter of the mother who never got to see her body, that body disappeared. I think she remembers the nurse as her mother could not. She puts her together in an act of tikkun olam. She stitches her back together, preserving those sacred wounds of martyrdom covered with roses. And in that extraordinary tenderness and that caring for the dead, that deep responsibility, that deep knowledge of the victims, even though never knowing them except through their absence and their presence among their loved ones, their disoriented loved ones, Salcedo becomes, in a sense, the mother of the lost, the hidden, and the destroyed. Is Doris Salcedo our civilization's official mourner? Perhaps she is, because we no longer know how to mourn, and we no longer even know how to return a dead person to her mother to take care of. But I wonder if she's not also our civilization's grieving, passionate, reburying, sanctifying, and resurrecting mother, the one who will keep us alive by not allowing us to forget the dead, all of them, who are our children, our parents, our cousins in Colombia, the dead who will soon be ourselves, as we hope and pray there will be someone to bury and remember us. Doris Salcedo, retriever and mother of the unwept, unburied, mother of the dead. If we forget them, her work says, then we are not fully human. We are not even fully alive. Thank you.
In ways that connect so deeply to many, 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 many conversations I've had with her, and conversations that really have circulated around her conversations with victims and survivors, focusing on the unburied dead, the ungrievable, the, is that good enough? Hold it, see if that's better. So much of what we've talked about since Judith's talk last night up through today, but with both of you in particular, one thing that I wanted to kind of begin with was, Mayra, you talked about the skin as being the place of the touch of tenderness and also the most vulnerable. And it was related in some way to the surface of many of Doris's works, but as we both kind of, you both came back to a fleur de piel in a really serious way, I think I'd like to start with that. Mm. And the skin as something that is shroud, as you so vividly showed in terms of recent photographs that I think brought home a very specific way for us to feel and know what this really means. And the shroud and the skin in a way in which in both various religious contexts and context of the custom of different civilizations over time, different cultures over time, and that role that the shroud plays, whether it's something that is covering a body that is no longer there, or is covering a body that is there, but is the tradition that this is to follow, relates in some way in my mind to ritual in both a cultural religious aspect as well as a societal aspect. Mm-hmm. I wondered if you, in your varied perspectives, you might comment on. And I relate that also to something Doris talks about that hasn't been mentioned in the last few talks, which is she sees her work as a kind of prayer. Mm-hmm. Prayer in the sense that ritual and the process of making, whether it's the sewing and the sewing mm-hmm. and the sewing, or it is actually the burnishing of the wood, the beautiful wood that's been rubbed and rubbed and rubbed, the cement brought into it, whether there are remnants of clothing in that or not. Everything she makes is a very lengthy process of ritual, but in that she's described it as a kind of prayer that she is making to those who are no longer here.
Right.
And we haven't talked about prayer, and that can be seen and interpreted, and that word in so many different mm-hmm. ways, but I would love to have, in particular, the two of you address that aspect of her work as well, if you might.
Mm-hmm. I think one of the things that I was interested in relation to the A Flor de Piel was the fact that the, you know, to use again, to come back to the language of the irreparable, right, the tearing of something in history, in time, and the action of the prescribed work to do something about it. And I see the shroud as so many ritual acts as a response to that tearing. And I also wanted to also complicate the idea that the work necessarily returns us back to the past, right, or repairs, or puts together a body, or actually repairs the past. And I see her work more as repairing something else. Mm. And one of the things I was interested in was in the ways that the pieces can evoke these complex relationships between bodies and objects, right, between in the relationship between bodies and objects that so often mediate everyday life,
right?
And that thinking both about how one of the things that might be in need of repair is that sense of relationship to the world, to the material world, to things, to the private furniture, to the home, but also to the public space. And this is where I thought Ana Maria's comments were really interesting, in the sense of thinking about it provoking the stitching together of a community. So both the relationship between the body and the space, a different space, and a different sense of community.
Yeah, I appreciate your bringing up. Did she say almost like a prayer? Is that what she said?
No, she said it's a kind of prayer.
It's a kind of prayer. In looking through her interviews and her writings, I think I mentioned, I was very struck by the recurrence of religious language. But I'm going to go back to her as universal mourner and universal mother. There's always a slight qualifier so that those who are not religious, and I don't know her own belief or how traditional she is, apart from her background, there's a space for them as well. So it's basically expanding, Michael Jackson does this in his work, the anthropologist, expanding the parameters of sacred. Mm-hmm. You know, I want my work to be a kind of sacred, almost like a sacred site or a kind of prayer. It's expanding it so that we can all enter into it. We live, particularly now, in such a polarized environment, and religious language often gets ethnographically scripted, or ethnically scripted, excuse me. Mm-hmm. And Christianity belongs to white people, and Islam belongs to brown people and Arab people, and in fact, not only are these traditions bigger, but even beyond their
quote-unquote official parameters, which is where most people live, in a very fluid place where the extremity of human experience is as holy, if not holier, than kind of official tropes or dogmatic tropes. In that place is, I think, where she also dwells and sees the holiness at those edges. When you were speaking about the effort, both of you, Mayra and Mary, I was just reminded of an extraordinary chance I had to many years ago when there was an exhibit on Islam that came. Can you imagine that happening now? Gosh, poor Muslims. Coming to I think it's called the World Trade Center here in Boston, and it was interesting. But one of the things they had there, one of the exhibits, was actually alive. It was the chief kiswa maker of the Kaaba. So the Kaaba is the great cube in the middle of Mecca, around which everyone circumambulates. It came down from heaven. It's associated with the sacrifice of Ishmael by Ibrahim. And every year it gets a new cover. Every year it's stitched with gold thread to make Quranic verses. And he was making the one for next year. And as soon as it's worn by the Kaaba, put on the Kaaba, it's taken off and they start all over. You have to have a brand new one. And when we look at that from utilitarian perspective, it seems really futile, really useless, like stitching rose petals together and having to infuse them and renew them like you will now have to do and the fog will have to do. But if you look at it through the lens of prayer, or like prayer, actually it connects the world, it repairs the world, it remakes the world. It's the most useful thing one can do. And I think we become ill spiritually and physically if we do not mourn. And if we do not mourn, as Mayra said, into the past, but also into the future and into different realms. I think we're sick because we don't care for our dead and because we're cut off from them. Even normal funerary ritual, even normal visitation of graves. So, apart from the abnormal and violent ones.
Related to the mourning and the need for that, one of the things that, Mayra, you said about observing a flor de piel, and I've been working on this for so long, and I had never thought about it in this way, and it relates completely to many of the things that you brought up as well, was the idea that when you go into that room, and it's not only that room that I'm actually asking this of people, but you go in, you said you bend your knees, you kneel down to see it closely. Mm-hmm. And one of the things I've talked about in the exhibition is the importance of the relationship of body to mm-hmm. each of her pieces, and body in the greater space, but that, and the importance of close looking and really observing. Mm-hmm. And as you said that, I was beginning to think of literally the idea of kneeling with reverence, with care, with the quiet of really thinking and remembering someone. And it brought to mind things that both of you had said, and whether the physical response we have as viewer, but in life, in mourning, is an important part of thinking about how we should relate to these works and how mm-hmm. so, mm-hmm. and also to what your recent point, which is
right.
the importance of mourning, and what does that mean physically and with the materials
right.
that she mm-hmm. sets up for us.
Right. Yeah, that's so beautifully put. Did you already tell the story about her lifting the pieces?
No, actually, I thought of that.
Can you tell the story?
I'd be very happy
okay,
to.
Okay, this is amazing.
Yeah. And it reminded me because Ana Maria talked about the piece that she just did in the center of Bogota and the people carrying the sheets with the names and the kind of quiet reverence they felt in carrying those sheets. The story that Kimberly's asking me to tell is when she installed a flor de piel. It was basically a process that took almost 8 days. She doesn't like to be watched installing it, but I did like hide and watch her and think she did give me some permission.
True confession. Total transparency.
So there are basically seven pieces to a fleur de piel, seven sheets of roses. And when she would pick up one of the sheets, first she asks for permission to touch it, and she's very serious about that. And in fact, we'll say that her studio assistants never ask permission. They actually end up tearing the sheets. And when she before she picks it up, it is never a sheet is never torn on her. But she carried it with this kind of incredible solemnity and deep emotion to move it over to place it on the floor. The sound of the sheet is it's a very quiet rustle, like a literal sheet, but
somehow with the weight of organic matter, it makes a different sound. And it was as if I literally had tears in my eyes, because it was as if she was carrying the skin of this
nurse.
Incredible nurse. It felt literally as if she was enacting mourning as she installed the piece, or just carried the sheet. And it was deeply moving.
Yeah, and I think when you first told me that, Mary, asked, and you may not, maybe this doesn't have a real one answer, but who do you think she was asking permission from?
She's never explained that.
What do you think? You've worked with her personally for so long, it's so deep in you. What do you think?
I think she deeply believes there is a greater spirit that is an important part of what guides us in the world, and that we need to be aware and respect that spirit.
So not the shroud and not the nurse, you think, but rather to a greater spirit?
It's possible the nurse is part of that,
right.
The reverence of her, because she's dead and the body is not actually there.
Right.
So I think that could be intertwined in some way.
That's so.
But I've never been asked that question, I think. But I think that's probably
it's beautiful.
I think another element that I would add, and I was wondering as I read her comments about it being a funerary oration, which she describes as the work of something that gives dignity to a ruined world. And the term dignity I was interested in, because there's similar terms in both Jewish and Christian traditional texts, where the term refers back to a Hebrew term that means to wait, actually. So it has that reference to really something that has weight. So it was really in relation to the other pieces too, that I was wondering about that connection of the dignity. But again, I think that the question that it prompts us to ask is what does it entail in relation to the world, right? That it opens up to that questioning of what does it entail? I think that's
the other point I wanted to bring back was when you talked about the role of in funerary tradition. There are going to be two points here: the funerary tradition of the mother, and you and I talked about this before today. Placing the body on the table and preparing in certain cultures, in particular, the responsibility of the mother, but the great love of the mother to bring the body of her child to a place in which then in the open casket everyone can see.
Exactly, yeah.
And then the Emmett Till example, I mean, it was deeply moving in that way, is something I think would be interesting to think about in terms of Salcedo's work and what isn't shown a body, but her process.
Right.
But secondly, the point that was made by Judith last night with the example of the mothers of the incredible education students on that bus who were, as we all know, murdered by police in Mexico, although that's never been officially announced in that way.
Right.
And their certainty that they will not mourn until something's found.
No, that's that for
all Asian mothers as well.
Yeah.
And so what is that about, or what can be said about body, or the remnant of, or the example that is left?
It's so ferocious. It's so ferocious and fierce. And when Judith told that story about, no, I'm not going to mourn, and I know he's not alive, but I'm not going to mourn, you know, that's the kind of disorientation and that liminal state that a mother, and by the way, I don't mean just a mother, and it can be an adopted mother, and it can be anyone who loves, but you know, that state that you are when you do not have a body. Now, that makes no sense. If you think about it from a utilitarian point of view, or a pragmatic point of view, or even an existential point of view, it doesn't make sense, but there it is, and it's really universal. Where is my body? And if I don't have the body, it's not about closure. This is much deeper than closure. You know, we have these silly phrases. There's a ferocity, so it's related to let us not forget, let my child not be erased, but it's actually much, much more. Back to the fetal cell exchange, part of my body's in that body. Part of my body's in that body. And so the child and I are actually a dyad. And so there's an element in which, you know, I am missing. I am missing if my child's missing. You know, my body's not complete.
This is pretty new research, so we're just becoming aware of the ways in which we're not individual, and you know, your mother's voice in your head, it turns out not to be metaphorical, it's actually there, and yeah.
For better or worse.
I just find this research horrifying. Right. Mothers think it's great.
You've also talked a lot about this, I know, so I'd love your body, especially Disremembered, for example.
I'm also interested in thinking about how bodies are tied to others that I may not even know, right? And I think that to also turn attention to the, we were talking about landscape earlier today, there was some mention of the agricultural practices of spraying people who are cultivating. So if we think about how that connection between bodies and material objects, but also bodies to one another through the medium of materiality, we can also think very broadly about the ways in which both our ties to others are so broad, in the way that I think that the a flor de piel and the dismembered, as Jude was saying last night, the repetitious pattern seems to evoke that sense of the expansiveness of this. In fact, in relation to, I think, what Ana Maria was saying before, I was wondering about this being about the not again. I think there's a possible element to also not again, because we know it might happen again and it's likely to happen again. That sense of a broader connection. And perhaps we can think about the awareness that those traces in the material objects bring to the connections between bodies and materiality more broadly, can also then help us think about links that are not only local but also more broader links that are mediated through materiality.
Questions? Geronimo. I don't know where they're. Get ready to project.
So thank you both and Mary for your comments. I have two questions. One has to do with this relationship between body individuality and materiality, especially as it relates to Salcedo's work, because in the exhibition that's upstairs, you see the first works are much more physical, and they are connected to a body of an individual that is not identified, right? Mm-hmm. And as we progress, if you will, into more individualized bodies, then the materiality of the work sort of like evaporates, mm-hmm. to the point that this new work, and Pallium says that was supposed to be for Chicago, and if I'm not mistaken, actually it will open this month in El Palacio de Cristal, with the difference, which is not minor, that the names are no longer going to be those of the victims of gun violence in Chicago, but rather the victims of migrants that have died in the Mediterranean. In those cases, there's no physical body, but there's the name, so mm-hmm. there's the individuality that needs to be mourned. Mm-hmm. And I'm curious about how does that need for the object is manifested in different cultures in terms of the mourning process. What is it more important, to have the remnants of the teeth of the body, or to have the individual as a concept be there present for the for the mourning process? So that's my first question. And my second question has to do with this idea of the mourner of our civilization, because part of what we were talking before and what Ana Maria was mentioning, I thought was very interesting, this idea of building, stitching together, of woving and creating a fabric that is also in parallel with the social fabric. And it made me remember the social practice that's still going on in especially women from upper class Colombia, which is they would gather together to sew and to produce garments for the poor, right? Mm-hmm. And it was this sort of like very well-intentioned activity that was creating community between the, among the elites, but also that was producing something that was kind of patriarchal in a way. They were solving the problems of the lower class. So I'm wondering, when it comes to religion studies and processes of mourning, how does that come into play? How can I mourn for the other? How can I sort of like create the sort of devices or objects that allow me to mourn the death of someone that I feel that it's close, but that it's not immediately close?
There's a lot in there that I'd love to talk more about. But I mean, I think in the first question of the relation that I was pointing to between the individual body and materiality, I include materiality more broadly, including air, right? So I think that there's a range of densities is how I would see the transition that is not insignificant from the first room to the disremembered. And in some ways, it's the air that takes the space of that one would imagine would a body would have occupied in the shirt, but it's still a hollowed space, not an absence, right? And we could talk about the ways in which even name may have those qualities or may connect. So it's that how language and discourse itself participates in the shaping of materiality. And so again, to expand the ways in which we may think about materiality and connection in more concrete ways. One thing I've been thinking about in relation to the conversations before about ritual and the having a discussion with a colleague who studies ritual, he was saying, well, you have to have a reference to a tradition that you are repeating in order for it to be considered a ritual, which brought me back to writings of a Caribbean poet who imagines what it is to create the possibilities of life in the Caribbean where the peoples emerge out of the devastation of the Middle Passage, where there's so much lost in that abyss. And he names the languages, the gods, and the rituals as part of all that was lost, including also the utensils that were used in everyday life. So, and one of the things that I found interesting about that is that he says we have no option but to create out of shards of vocabulary fragments of rituals, right? And I think there are in some conditions of devastation, some conditions of displacement, where there are the rituals need to be created. And I think what's a lot of what we've seen here, you know, the body is not available to conduct the ritual we would expect to, or we don't know the names of those who suffered here. And I see a lot of the examples that have been given throughout the day as examples of people struggling to create a ritual when all the necessary pieces are not in place. So they are actually creating from fragments of rituals and shards of vocabulary.
I really appreciated your second question also. What was your name?
Hieronimo.
Hieronimo, thank you. Yeah, how, given that death preserves social caste and injustice, even, you know, the ways that the dead are interred is informed by their economic and social status in every culture. You know, it doesn't disappear suddenly. And then the issue of beneficence without change. Eva Perón comes to mind, giving away washing machines, right? You get a car and you get a car. How can we mourn for those who are different, or how can we enter into mourning for them? And also, I think your question has an implication of how can death mediate social change, or a kind of a questioning or a challenge to those systems? Is that so that the donor system doesn't end up reinscribing the injustice? Is that?
Yeah, I mean, part.
What can mediate?
In terms of like connecting and because one thing is to sort of like empathize,
right,
understand the value of a life, and right, another one is to mourn it, right?
You're right, there's a huge difference. Hieronimo, this doesn't happen enough, it rarely does, but I saw an amazing photograph. I work in Israel a lot in a conference of Jewish, Christian, and Muslim theologians, and a lot of people, including my really smart, cynical brother-in-law, who's a retired paramedic and now a professor of Jewish literature, love to tell me how useless it is, and that's fine, you know, I've been doing it for 20 years. But in the course of that, and some of the things that I read, I came across a photo describing what had happened by one of the participants who had been organized, who is an interfaith rabbi, works with other faiths, for the teenager who was burned alive. The Muslim teenager who was burned alive a couple of years ago in retaliation for the deaths of some Israeli teenagers in the West Bank. He was burned alive in East Jerusalem. And this was the relatives in East Jerusalem lined up, the female relatives lined up to receive mourners. And up and down the row, kneeling before them, were Jewish women, observant Jewish women who had come. They were kneeling before the bereaved relatives of the teenager, and their hands, it was a traditional gesture, were on their knees. You know, I'm so sorry, I comfort you. You know, and it was Jews who had burned him alive. And I can't tell you what the expressions were, because there was so much grief, it almost mask-like, of the mother. And I can't tell you, I can't sit there and say, oh, they look so moved, and it was so meaningful. No, it was just like almost shock. But I saw what was in the faces of the Jewish women, and it was yearning. It really, all of them. I yearn to comfort you. So I think mourning does create those opportunities. I think death creates those opportunities to equalize, even temporarily. I think it moves things a little bit. And as I said, I think what Salcedo is trying to do, she's pretty explicit about it, is to say that if things back up and we forget and we don't go forward with mourning, we actually get clogged up. And because the dead are always there, it's not like they go anywhere, you know, they're always there. So I think it's actually one of the great places to begin change. Is, you know, there's an amazing requirement at the Roxbury Latin School. This is where I wish I could send my daughter, but it's all boys. I have two girls. I have a little one. And the requirement is for the seniors, and they all have to do it, they have to create funerals and have services for dead veterans who have no families, because there's a VA hospital right next to Roxbury Latin. And by that, I mean they have to carry the, they can't prepare the corpse, of course, but it's not allowed, but they have to carry the dead soldier, and they have to be his family while he is, depending on his tradition, while he is eulogized. And they have to bury him physically with shovels. And they all have to do it, it's required. That is a good school. That is a good school. That is what we should all be doing. Yeah.
Thank you so much. I'm gonna thank you both for an incredible session.